up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. Well, it's interesting. All those years ago, Bob Marley had it so right. How did he know? Well, maybe he had good drugs. I don't know. But if you don't know your rights, how are you going to stand up for your rights? So although he was telling you to stand up for your rights, he didn't tell you how to stand up for your rights. So hopefully, with this little presentation, all you out there in Freemanland are going to have a little bit more knowledge of what your rights are and who and how they are taking your rights away from you. Okay, we know that the biggest problem is that the police and government departments rely on acts of parliament to control us. So we need to look at the acts first to see how they're controlling us and what they're doing. So today we're going to have a look at the Crimes Act and see what the Crimes Act says about our rights. And the Crimes Act 1961 here in New Zealand, I'm sure it won't be too different wherever you are. Okay, Section 9, offences not to be punishable except under New Zealand Acts. Yeah, well, that sounds about right. You would want to come under the own acts of your own land, would you not? Maybe not. No one shall be convicted of any offence at common law or of any offence against any act of the Act of Parliament of England or the Parliament of Great Britain or the Parliament of the United Kingdom. We're not worried about those, but that first one there that's highlighted in yellow, no one shall be convicted of any offence at common law. That's rather interesting, isn't it? Oh, nothing in this section shall limit or affect the power or authority of the House of Representatives or of any court to punish for contempt. I want you to hold that thought. Punish for contempt. Now we look at the people who most people don't have a lot of contact with unless they're driving around without licenses or doing silly things like that. So we'll have a look at the police site. Now I would suggest you do the same in your country wherever you are. But our one, pretty fancy looking site. They've done a great job of it here. Now, unfortunately, I can't get the whole page. This page is bigger. So I'm going to flick over to the next page where the bottom of the page is there. And the first sentence there looks rather important. So I'll highlight it and read it to you. It's important for us to know what people of New Zealand think of our service. In New Zealand, we police by consent and cannot afford to lose the support of the people we serve. Did I read that right? In New Zealand, we police by consent. Well, that's what we are. It's so simple when you know your rights, isn't it? Number one, we cannot be charged with any crimes. Two, they can only do it with our consent. And three, they can only punish us for contempt. My goodness, they've got thousands and thousands of different charges in there, but they can only punish us for one of them, and that's for contempt, and they can only do it with our consent. Now, if you've seen any of my other videos, you'll know that name spelt in all capitals is a deceased estate and a corporation, and as a corporation, we can be taken to court, or the corporation can be taken to court, not us, only the corporation. So we've got to rebut the presumption that we are a corporation. But what they rely on is ignorance of the law is no excuse. Doesn't matter how ignorant they are, they can always duck out the back and go through another dozen law books, go online and check or ring someone up. But they are the controllers of us, and therefore it's only our ignorance of the law that they worry about. However, once you know your rights, we need to know a few simple facts or they will force us into contract. Now, everything that we do is about contract laws. So unless we know what contract law is and how they force us into the contract, we're going to come unstuck every time. So listen up. This is called the honor-dishonor principle. We must remain honourable at all times, whenever they question us or send us an invitation to contract. Now, a lot of people are sending letters back. A lot of people are arguing in making all sorts of outrageous claims when all they have to do is learn this principle. Never remain silent. Never argue. Never agree with them without a condition. Now, here's the reason. Silence, the state of a person who does not speak or one who refrains from speaking. Pure and simple silence cannot be considered as a consent to a contract, okay? Pure and simple silence cannot be considered as a consent to a contract, except in cases when the silent person is bound in good faith to explain himself, in which case silence gives consent. So if you remain silent when asked a question, you are giving consent, pure and simple. So never remain silent. Never argue. Now, down the bottom here, it says, the logicians define it more scientifically to be a means by which its connection between two extremes establishes a relation between them, or a relationship between them. Okay? So if we argue, we have a relationship with them. In other words, they have joined or they have a contract. Okay, what we should always do is accept what they say upon them verifying in writing that what they claim is the truth. Now, they're not going to like that. But however, I always accept what they say is correct. But would you mind putting what you say in writing and signing it for me? They're not going to like that. They're going to try all sorts of excuses. No, we can't do that. So, well, would you mind withdrawing your outrageous claim? Okay, and here's a situation that some of you naughty people do face from time to time. You were speeding. Would you kindly define speeding? You're going to throw them onto the back foot. Now, what I would suggest in a situation is that you always carry a recording device. Now, a lot of the iPhones and these new modern techno phones have got built-in videos on them. So I would always hold the camera up whenever you are confronted and say, I am recording this. It will be put on YouTube and will be used as evidence against you. Now, they will modify their stance dramatically once you start doing this sort of thing. But you have to realize that they're doing a job, but if you're conversant with the law, you can ask for clarification. So you say, I'm sure you won't mind us asking for clarification, would you? Be polite. Always be polite. These guys are doing a job, but they must be starting to realize that some of the things that they're saying and doing are not right. Uphold your rights, but be polite. When a police officer wishes to question you, his actions fall under one of three areas. These are the only three areas: contact, detention, or arrest. Okay? If they catch you committing a crime, they can detain or arrest you. But the contact area is where most of us will come first. And a contract with you must be consensual. Now, I showed you that on the website. It must be consensual. A police officer has not yet formulated enough suspicion of any wrongdoing to elevate this beyond a mere, may I ask you a few questions? You may be questioned, but you have the right to refuse to answer and the right to walk away from a contract. Now, you saw that silence is a contract, so do not refuse to answer. What I would suggest you do is say, do I have the right to remain silent? And if the officer says yes, say, then I choose to remain silent. That way you have not gone silent, so you have no contract. But be careful. As everything is consensual, whatever you say will be used against you. So the safest way is to ask questions. Never make outrageous claims. The person who makes a claim says, oh, I'm not that person. You then are required to prove it. Okay? So don't make those claims. Just ask questions. So now I'm going to teach you another thing, which is the rule of three. And I'm sure your parents used to say good things come in three or bad things come in three. Jesus asked Peter three times, do you love me? On the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. The Holy Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. What is this fascination with three? Well, it's one of their rules. We must ask the same question three times. If we only ask it once, we're going to be caught by them. So we must do it three times. So whenever we're talking to anyone that is trying to get us into a legal contract, we must rebut them three times. Plain and simple. Once is not good enough. It must be three times. Now, just in case you don't know what rebut is, it means to disprove, dispute, defeat, counter, refute, or take away the effect of. So we must disprove them three times, or we must repel them three times. Get that very clear in your head, because what happens when you fail to rebut them is an adhesion contract takes place. Now, here's what an adhesion contract is. They're not nice. A type of contract, a legally binding agreement between two parties to do a certain thing, in which one side has all the bargaining power and uses it to write the contract primarily to his or her advantage. Oh dear. An example of an adhesion contract is a standardized contract form that offers goods or services to consumers on essentially a take-it-or-leave-it basis, without giving consumers realistic opportunities to negotiate terms that would benefit their interests. So it's one-sided, it's against us. When this occurs, the consumer cannot obtain the desired product or service unless he or she acquiesces, which means agrees, to the form contract. There is nothing unenforceable or even wrong about adhesion contracts. In fact, most businesses would never conclude the volume of transactions if it were necessary to negotiate all the terms of every consumer credit contract. Consumer credit, contract. Everything is about a contract. Everything is about credit. We do not want an adhesion contract. It's very one-sided. It's to their advantage. So we must rebut it three times. Now, if you've ever been in court, like I have many times, and if you've ever tried to rebut the judge three times, you'll know what I'm talking about next. The first time you rebut or question a judge, he will ever so politely explain himself in more detail, thinking that you may not have understood or not quite have heard what was going on. But the second time is when it becomes serious. All the lawyers will spin around and laugh and question you and go, "Oh, ho, ho, what's going on with you? What drugs are you on?" But if you watch the judge, he will immediately hit the panic button. It's on the floor. He hits it with his foot. And this brings the security and police racing into the court. They're all wired up. They hear the cry for help. They come in. They stand around you and intimidate you. Now, one of the things a lot of people say, never cross the bar, never do this, never do that. I don't have a problem with crossing the bar. You shouldn't be in the court anyway. So if you're going to stand at the back and play around like a fool, just walk straight in and own the court is much better than all this pussyfooting around. Walk in. I put my books on the back, put my law dictionary and everything on the back table, sit down and then harass the lawyers. Do the same. Okay, the judge will at this point try his utmost to shut you down with threats and intimidation. Or, I've seen some of them, try politely one more time to clarify the situation. Okay, but if you hold your ground and ask or challenge a third time, then the judge must vacate his bench. I've had it happen to me so many times, I know it for a fact. There is absolutely no question that when you get to the third time, they must vacate the bench. Now, I saw it once where a friend of ours who we'd coached got before the judge and she says, you realize now that we have got a serious situation. If you do not get a lawyer by the next court hearing, we are in serious trouble because we are now talking the law of the land. Now, what she was telling us was that he had taken her off the sea, off the maritime law and onto the land, and they were in trouble, not him. Unless he got someone to represent him, they were gone. So it is the truth. I know this for a fact. But he won't be happy. And don't be fooled. Now, this is a commercial maxim. He who leaves the battlefield first loses by default. The judge will vacate the chair. He will walk out of the room. But if you leave the field without saying what you want, you're in trouble. The primary users of commercial law and those who best understood and codified it in Western civilization are the Jews. This is Mosaic law. They have had it for more than 3,500 years and is based upon Babylonian commerce. And the legal maxim, he who does not repel a wrong when he can, occasions it. So it's important because now you are the court. And this is what you must do. You must say, he who leaves the field of battle first loses by default. And then you must follow up. For the record, case dismissed. And don't ever forget, if you don't know your rights, then you have no rights.